light in life. But now I know what the edge of a knife feels like. I know what it feels like crying to myself. This is hell. Don't cry alone tonight. There's no reason that we have to fight. Now I'm trying and trying to be my own good philosophy, but do not recommend to you that you try not to do the things you want to. Now it's over and I'm trying not to make sure that my luck doesn't die. Oh, I cry every night and day. I'm trying just to live the way I should. And I've tried and tried to do everything that I could ever do. And now I know that I'm try to slide through life like dental floss. But I don't wanna be who I am, and I don't have any plans to be stronger than I am right now. Cause nothing I can do will show how to be myself. Now I'm trying so hard not to walk down the boulevard of pain that's in my brain. And I've been trying so much, but I've failed so many times. And it doesn't matter if you can sing or make rhymes. Just trying to be someone that I'm not. Something people do a lot, and it's sad as hell how we all gonna cry in the end.
Was that your own song?
I just made that up.
Okay. You should release it.
So that's recorded now, right?
Yeah.
So this is, I tried to sort of condense it a little bit. Some, from something longer I wrote, tried to make it 5 to 7 minutes, but if it's too long, you can feel free to cut me off. This is called Despite the Serpent. Gloucester is where I learned to swim. It's where English colonists established the first fishing port of the New World, and it's the last slip of land 10,000 fishermen saw before they drowned at sea. My great-grandmother moved to Gloucester in 1955. She abandoned her previous life of worldly adventures to pursue her admiration for the Atlantic. She could name every bird in the sky and every fish in the sea, but her particular interest was tide pools. The tide leaves puddles in the rocks when it recedes, which wash away in the high tide before the receding waves deposit a new trove of ocean critters. She compiled some of her knowledge in a nautical guidebook, The Sea Is All About Us, which has inspired new generations of tide pool prospectors, particularly me and my cousins. One Gloucester mystery remains unsolved, and it began with an odd tide pool discovery. In August of 1817, the Linnaean Society of Boston, a group of scholars and amateur scientists, drafted a report that classified a new genus, the Scoliophus atlanticus, or the Gloucester sea serpent. Their conclusion was based on a multitude of serpent sightings in the Gloucester harbor and a 3-foot black snake found in a tide pool. The Linnaean Society had arrived in Cape Ann following a Boston Daily Advertiser article that described a prodigious snake in the Gloucester harbor, seen by hundreds of people in the past week. The society jumped at the opportunity. Recently formed and already labeled a glorified boys' club, they were eager to prove their scientific mettle by locating and identifying the Gloucester sea serpent. Interviews with locals painted a shaky image of the creature. Accounts contested whether it swam parallel to the water in a side-to-side motion like a traditional snake, or dove above the waves in great arches. Its head, often seen protruding tall from the waves, was flat like a turtle's, larger than a dog's, but smaller than a horse's. Body length varied between 60 to 100 feet long. Gorham Norwood, a Gloucester resident, attracted attention when he found and killed a meter-long snake with a bumpy, undulating spine similar to descriptions of the serpent. The Linnaean Society purchased the specimen for dissection from a reluctant Norwood. They returned to Boston elated. Not only had they compiled sufficient evidence from trustworthy local sources, they had captured the progeny of the great serpent. Gloucester sea serpent season boomed in 1818. People visited from Boston and Marblehead to line the coast from Niles Beach to Stage Fort Park in hopes of viewing the famous sea serpent. They weren't disappointed. The long, dark form often circled 10-Pound Island before sliding past the breakwater and out to sea. General David Humphreys, a former member of George Washington's staff, an avid fan of 18th-century poetry, wasn't satisfied with the Linnaean Society's conclusions on the Gloucester sea serpent the previous year. He wanted a body. He offered upwards of $5,000 for a successful killing, reward notice dripping with his usual romantic flair. Who will dare to put a hook in his nostrils, transfix his sides with a spear, or engage in single combat with Vulcanian arms, the monarch of the deep, in his own element? Humphreys answered his own question below. The fishermen and whalemen with which Cape Ann and Marblehead abound may doubtless be reckoned in the class of the most bold, enterprising, and dexterous mariners in the world. Gloucester fishermen continued to live up to Humphreys' exaggerated adulations. I have a friend who works on a Gloucester lobster boat. His life depends on a small knife strapped to his chest, as the threat of a line snagging a limb and dragging him down below the wake of the lobster boat forever is omnipresent. He often returns home with his forearms shredded from needle-sharp spikes on the lobster's claws. He enjoys the constant risk. The intricacies of daily life seem arduous and convoluted in his eyes, and he takes comfort in relinquishing control to the deep. The ocean multiplies our weaknesses and makes our vulnerabilities visible. In open water, we are defenseless. We're never truly in control of our lives, and the ocean makes this crystal clear. Gloucester developed into an indispensable fishing port due to its proximity to George's Bank and other ocean banks bordering the coast of Nova Scotia and Newfoundland. These patches of raised seabed maroon in the deep offer shelter to cod and halibut, lucrative for those brave enough to venture into the stormy waters. However, the sea demands an exchange of life. Beyond the spires of churches, tall ships, and the town hall, on the boulevard that separates the city center from the sea, stands the Gloucester Fisherman's Memorial. The bronze statue hunches over his steering wheel, gazing at the horizon, face and oilskins oxidized green from the weather. Below him are the words, "They that go down to the sea in ships." The names of thousands of fishermen are inscribed in granite along the base. Sailors who never returned home between 1623 and 1923. Gloucester fisheries have fed dozens of ships to the ocean's maw each year. From 1866 to 1890 alone, almost 400 schooners and 2,500 Gloucester sailors sunk. A single storm in 1873 claimed the lives of 128 fishermen. Tragedies grew so frequent that a house was built in Gloucester for fishermen's widows and had 30 rooms available for $3 a month. Even today, anxious parents and spouses stand on wooden widow walks atop old houses or line the boulevard, watching and hoping for their loved one's safe return. In the summer of 1818, Captain Richard Rich, a renowned whaler, decided to catch the Gloucester sea serpent. He assembled a crew, selecting from among the surging number of sailors who claimed to have witnessed the serpent. He had seen the creature himself earlier that month, after learning its swimming habits from local reports. He knew that it appeared during calm weather when the atmospheric pressure grew high. On September 6th, Rich checked his barometer. He nodded to his first mate. While locating the rest of his crew, Rich received news that beachgoers had spied the serpent lurking over a sandbar. Captain Rich's schooner glided across the glassy sea. They could see for miles. A ridge of ripples appeared on the horizon, led by an angular head. Harpoons in hand, they sailed toward the bobbing curls. Rich asked each person in his ship if the distant creature matched their previous sightings. Everyone concurred it must be the serpent. Captain Richard Rich chased the Gloucester sea serpent for 5 days. Each attempt at spearing its slippery head merely pushed it further down the Cape Ann coastline. The creature's arced coils churned the ocean behind it, stretching impossibly long. On the fifth night, Rich stood alone by the helm, leaning on his harpoon. To starboard, the moon's light glittered on the serpent's slick scales. Beast and boat drifted close together. Captain Rich clutched the gunwale. He saw the serpent's huge eyes rippling below the surface and threw his harpoon. Splash, shunk. The sea turned black with blood as Rich hauled at the thrashing creature. His crew emerged from their cabin, startled by the sudden struggle. Rubbing sleep from their eyes, the men grasped for the harpoon line and dragged Rich's catch onto the deck. "Where's the tail?" someone asked. Captain Rich securely wrapped the faintly flopping form with a nearby sailcloth. He forbade anyone from speaking of this event once they reached shore. As the sun rose above the Gloucester coast and Rich's crew shooed seagulls off the mast, the large white mound on the deck slowly bloomed red. Back on shore, Captain Richard Rich refused to uncover his catch. It lay rotting on his schooner's deck for days. He did not want to shatter the illusion that he had bested the Gloucester sea serpent. Eventually, he revealed it to be a 12-foot horse mackerel, commonly known as an Atlantic bluefin tuna. Captain Rich had confirmed his hunch when he caught the tuna. The segments of the serpent's body he had seen leaping above the water were a school of jumbo fish, as he had expected. The Boston Society of Natural History officially debunked the Linnaean Society's Scoliophus Atlanticus classification in 1863. Their baby serpent was a common eastern racer with tumors on its spine. However, the fact remains that hundreds of people saw a serpent in the Gloucester Harbor between the years of 1817 and 1819. I don't think Captain Rich ever believed he could catch the serpent, as most Gloucester fishermen understood. They saw the serpent as the unassailable sea, flaunting its monstrosity in the safe harbor. Beyond the breakwater was his true territory. How many mothers have looked out to sea for their sons and seen only the serpent? Is it so hard to believe that a community funded by drowning witnessed a sea monster? The Gloucester sea serpent appeared early in the 19th century, a harbinger of the deadliest era for Gloucester fishing. Deep sea fishing vessels sailed straight into the serpent's jaws. On shore, mourners watched the serpent play among the moored schooners, inviting them out to sea for it to feast. I grew up paddling kayaks through places called Norman's Woe or Folly Cove, commemorating terrible shipwrecks. As a child, I took no notice. Now, I still feel safe and serene swimming in the Gloucester Harbor, but I respect the unpredictability of the sea. Despite everything, fishermen still kiss their spouses and children goodbye before stepping aboard floating tombs. My friend and other young people still risk their lives for the ocean bounty. Filmmakers, painters, and writers are tied to Gloucester by a net of grief. The sea serpent lurks behind every rock and wave, but we still swim.